here to present a presentation about the dissect committee of the United Nations. So here I am going to brief us about the dissect committee.
So I'll describe the committee. The Disarmament and the International Security Committee was established in 1993. It is the first of the six main committees in General Assembly. DISEC's mandate is to promote the establishment and maintenance of international peace and security, with at least diversion on armaments for the human world and economic resources. DISEC deals with the international peace and security. The topics considered are similar to those discussed in Security Council, but unlike Security Council, DISEC does not have the ability to pass authorized interventions since they are part of the General Assembly. Now, DISEC works in close cooperation with the United Nations Disarmament Commission and Geneva Peace Conference. Now, the functions of the DISEC is similar to those of a UNGA. So the rules, the functions, and the power of UNGA is also applied to those of DISEC. Now I'd like to hand over my
Sure. So the DISEC committee works in preventing extortion and terrorism. So there are countries like Qatar which are actually promoting terrorism or like supporting terrorism, and because of that, the complete United Arab Emirates has stopped completely like the social and economic ties with Qatar. So the DISEC committee has launched an act for the Arms Trade Treaty, which basically regulates the trade of arms and finance to countries. So So the Arms Trade Treaty protects the country's property abuse to the international humanitarian law. So then the CBSE, or the Counterterrorism Committee, protects countries from terrorism activities. If any activity is detected, then they simply just freeze the transactions of arms and trades. They also ensure that the whole committee is dedicated to stopping trades of arms. And I pass on the mic to Abhishek.
Good afternoon. I appreciate going to speak on development of communication and IT sector. As all of us know, the origin of computer dates back many centuries. The first analytic engine was developed by Mr. Charles in 19th century. Then the first digital computer was developed for the US Army in 1946 in the times of World War II, known as ELAC. Later in decades, national authorities and government has attempted to exploit the ICT to enhance communication, better communication between society and government. The ICT mainly refers to the media to provide us to access information through telecommunication. Example, cyberspace. Cyberspace gives us many opportunities to access. It gave us many opportunities that provide us to access information. And collect back data at a very vast speed. And it also helps us in teaching methods, such as providing information, teaching methods, layouts to enhance students' performance. As all of us know, the rapid development in IT sector has led to many threats, such as terrorism. By the author of book, Urban Terrorism Baseline, he has compared terrorists with media communication by comparing by saying that it consists of four components such as transistor, the terrorist, and the receiver, the target. Then the message bombing and the feedback, the reaction of the people to their act. For this thing, in the UN, in 2004 and 2009, two groups have been formed to deal with cyberspace and cybersecurity. In 2011, of these two groups, another group of United Nations Institute of Disarmament was formed to review these policies and make a strong policy to deal with cyber security and cyberspace.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gautam, and I'll be talking about cyber warfare. Now, what is cyber warfare? Cyber warfare is when a state, an international organization, or a non-state actor infiltrates another nation's communication systems and networks to cause some sort of disruption. Now, I'm going to be talking about cyber terrorism mostly. Cyber terrorism is the international use of disruptive methods against another nation's networking systems and communication systems to cause any sort of harm to the nation's ideological, social, and economic objectives, or to intimidate their government into preventing them from implementing these objectives. Now, cyber terrorism, based on this aspect, it divides into two definitions: effect-based and intent-based. Now, effect-based is when, in cyber terrorism, when the computer attacks result in such effects that cause some sort of harm, some sort of fear among the masses, that it can be comparable to an act of, a traditional act of terrorism, even if it is caused by any other normal criminal. For example, when cyber terrorists hack into the defense system networks of another nation, they will be unable to coordinate against an imminent threat to their country. Also, intent-based, when an unlawful or a politically motivated computer attack with malicious intent aims to intimidate a nation's government into preventing them from implementing their objectives or causing some sort of economic harm. Now, who is a cyber terrorist? A cyber terrorist is a state sponsor or a non-state actor who uses cyber attacks in order to achieve their goals. They may consist of international terrorists or some sort of rebels that utilize the internet in order to carry out organized attacks. For instance, in 2012, cyber terrorists launched a fatal virus attack on Aramco, which is a Saudi Arabian oil corporation. The attack wiped out almost 35,000 computers of their information. So, cyber terrorists mainly aim to exploit another country's vulnerability in their networking system in order to achieve their goals. So, I'll be talking about some of their objectives of the cyber attack. They include loss of integrity, that is, when an attack may cause information of the nation to be modified improperly. Loss of availability, where critical information on the nation may be unavailable to authorized users. Loss of confidentiality, where information may be disclosed to those who are not authorized to access them. Or physical harm, where the networks can actually cause harm to the masses. So, since I'm talking about cyber terrorists, it is important to mention about who are cyber warriors. Now, cyber warriors are a group of expert-based hackers who work under the consent of the government in order to support their military operations. For example, in 2007, Siberia wanted to launch a new airstrike against Syria. Now, before this, before they launched the attack, a group of hackers hacked into the defense system of Syria and disabling them, and they weren't able to coordinate against the attack, and hence the country had to suffer severe casualties because of it. Like I said before, cyber warriors may act under the consent of the government, or they may not act under the consent. The best example is North Korea, who organized a group of cyber hackers consisting of 6,400 personnel, experts who are aiming to politically paralyze South Korea and causing them harm in their economy or infrastructure. Now, effective measures have been taken against the imminent threat of a cyber attack. For example, as far as the European Union is concerned, all of the member states have adopted the national cyber security strategy in order to protect their nations from imminent threat of a cyber attack. For example, Finland in 2013 stated that they would adopt this strategy to help them improve their cyber capabilities, cyber warfare, as well as recruiting worthy personnel for their advancement. And the Netherlands also adopted this strategy to develop their cyber defense strategies as well as the cyber offensive military operations. Thank you.